So yeah, so thank you very much for the possibility of giving this talk. For me, it's an honor to be here. So what I want to talk about, I was thinking about the talk, and somehow my idea then was to give some sort of survey of this about the circle of ideas surrounding the notion of stability in the derived category. And some of this theory was somehow built like about 15 years ago. And he was born from in the subject of mathematical physics. But what I want to stress today, which is more related to the conference, I want to stress like the relation with rational geometry. So there is a problem about this theory. The problem is that the theory is still not yet completely developed. So somehow it works sort of well for surfaces. And some result can be proven in surface case. And starting from threefold, the theory becomes sort of essentially everything is unknown except a few examples, but at least we have some idea what happens in the threefold case. And in higher dimension, we have essentially no idea what's going on. But somehow we can somehow speculate that there should be some sort of inductive process, and that's what I'm going to talk today. So, but let me start with the definition. Let me say, first of all, that I work, everything is over C in my talk. And although the first definition are general, so let me define what I mean by stability first. And so before talking about derived category, I'll start with abelian categories. So let me take A, an abelian category. Maybe introduce just the basic definition at the beginning. So by stability, I mean something which is a slope stability. So first of all, I define a notion of weak stability. So weak stability condition. So what's a weak stability condition? A weak stability condition is the data. So this is my category A, and I want to have two functions, R and D. So what are they? So R is a rank function. So R goes from A into the real numbers, and I want to be a rank, so I want to be positive. So this is a rank, or better, generalized rank. And I want a degree function, which goes from A into R. And that is a degree. I want them to be compatible with the structure of a abelian category, so it means I want them to be additive on short exact sequence. Okay. And for being able to define a sort of slope stability, I want the following condition. This is the condition of being weak, which says the following. If the rank of an object is equal to 0, then I want the degree of the object to be positive. Okay. So this is a weak notion because, for example, 0 will work. But anyway, so 0 function will work, but still. So this gives you some notion. And once I have these two functions, let me just recall you can define a notion of slope in the usual way, just by setting the slope of an object. So A is an object in A, minus 0. And so I define the slope as follows in the usual way. So I define it as plus infinity if the rank is 0. And otherwise, I define as degree divided by the rank. Okay. And so this notion of slope gives a notion of stability in the usual way. So I can define A to be semi-stable if the following thing happens, sorry for this notation, if the usual thing, so for all object B inside A, maybe let me assume that B is non-zero, I want to have that the slope of B is smaller or equal than the slope of A. So that's the first thing I want. So that's the first property. And then since it's a general context, I want to add another assumption. And the second assumption is that part two, I want that every object which is not semi-stable admit a finite filtration in semi-stable objects whose slopes are uniquely ordered. And so this is what is called a harder Anaximander filtration. So harder Anaximander filtrations exist in A with respect to this stability. OK, so that's the notion of stability that I'm caring about. OK, so this is a weak notion. So this is easy to find examples, as I said. We'll see many later. Now there is a better notion of stability, which is what we are aiming at, which is the notion, so now I call it a stability condition. So what is a stability condition? A stability condition is a weak stability condition such that so the same property as I listed there, but what I want this condition on the rank to be much stronger. So I want the following. So if the rank of an object is equal to zero, I want that the degree is strictly positive. Okay? So that's where so that's what I'm aiming at. So I want to construct stability conditions, and I want to understand a bit this condition and the implication in on rational geometry, for example. Okay, let me just give you a quick example. So the example where everything is modeled is a slope stability for sheaves. So let me take X, smooth projective variety. Let me take N is the dimension. Then I can construct a weak stability conditions easily. Somehow, first of all, I have to fix an ample divisor class. And then I take A as the category of coherent sheaves on X. I take R as the usual rank. And I take D as the usual degree. So the degree of something on an n-dimensional, I have to pair it with the first churn class with an ample divisor. And so this is well known. So this is a weak stability condition. And it is a stability condition if and only if the dimension is equal to 1. Okay. So for curves, this is a stability condition in the strong sense. In general, you have objects, for example, skyscraper sheaf, for which rank and degree are both equal to 0. Okay, and actually, it's actually stronger, the statement, somehow. So this is with respect to this rank and degree. But the actual statement is that for any function you can define R and D, coherent sheaf will never work. So coherent sheaf will never be the heart, be giving you a stability condition in this strong sense. Okay, so that's the first problem. So that's one example. Somehow the second example is a bit more interesting. So this seems sort of hopeless. The second, if you take A, a finite dimensional algebra, associative algebra, over my field, which you see, and I look at the category A of finite dimensional modules over A, then here it's easy to define a stability condition in the strong sense. I just take the rank. So I have a module is finite dimensional vector space, I can take its dimension. And then since the module is a vector space, I say the dimension is always positive. So I can choose D any function, and this will give me a stability condition. Okay. So that's a second example. And so here I can construct many examples. Here I can construct essentially none. So the way in which the theory goes is that, OK, this is a general thing. So the goal of what I want to do, I want somehow to find a replacement for coherent sheaves, and for which I can define some sort of stability condition related to a category, to a variety x in any dimension. And so how do I do this goal? Well, generally, the idea is the following, is that instead of looking at coherent sheaf, you look at the derived category of coherent sheaves. So you start by taking dbx. And you define as the bounded derived category of coherent sheaves on X. And you're asking A to be not a random abelian category, but you want A to be a bounded, a heart of a bounded structure. So I ask A inside the dbx to be the heart of a bounded T structure. So for example, coherent sheaf is good. And in general, a heart simply means that every complex can be somehow written as finite extension of sheaves of objects which are in A. Okay, so that's what it means to be. So my classical example that you have to keep in mind is the following. Somehow, why this thing, it's somehow you can hope to get some hint about this problem. But the idea, the intuition here is that if you take x equal to pn, so it's a well-known result by Bellinson is that the derived category
of coherent sheaf of Pn is actually equivalent to the derived category of finitely generated modules over of finite dimensional modules over a certain algebra, which is just endomorphism, for example, of a certain number of line bundles. And so, sure. Bounded simply means this, the thing I told you now. So it means that somehow every object, every complex here, can be written as a finite extension of sheaf of object in A. So it's the key is the finiteness. Okay, so that's what it means, bounded. And somehow, again, coherent sheaf is the classical example. This one is the second example, somehow. Okay, so that's. Or if you want, somehow the intuition is that somehow you have a category A for which dBA is somehow the same as dBx. So the B is there. Okay, all good. Okay, so if I take Pn, this is a classical example. So the category of Pn is the same as category of finite dimensional model of a certain algebra. And now I know how to construct stability somehow associated to Pn because I just take this category. Okay, so the idea is that if you add this assumption, so I will keep this assumption now from now on. So for me, a stability condition will always be an abelian category, which is the heart inside the bounded derived category of coherent sheaf on X. And then I'm asking the same question. So can I find something of this form there? Okay. So. Yeah, in this case it's the same, yeah, because, It's just a dimension so it's a vector space, a module here, so I'm just taking a dimension as a vector space. Yeah, but it's still over C, dimension over C, I'm sorry. I find dimension as vector spaces, and then I just take dimension, sorry. I'm sorry, I should have added C, thanks. I apologize for it. Yeah. Okay, good. So that's the introduction. So now the question is, let me give a bit of motivation. At the moment, I will be imprecise, and later I will be precise. Sure.
But then when you find the stability condition, it involves only the
part of the category. Yeah, I will involve somehow. It will be a triple stability condition from now on, in which A will be at the heart of a bounded structure, and then I have these two functions here. So that's the thing that I want to consider in the future, somehow, in this talk. Yeah. So those are this is my data. So A is the heart, and R D are the function. Yeah, that's it. And then I want something more, but I will tell you later somehow. Somehow this is not giving a nice theory. I will need to add some assumption on the somehow. This give you somehow. This is too general at the moment still. But we'll see in the example. I need something more actually. Somehow let me tell you now. Somehow I need something. Somehow you see here R and D are real functions. I want to be allowed to vary them. That's the main technique that I'm going to use. So I need some condition of boundedness. I'm talking about it later. Yeah. But let me just give you, before finishing this introduction, let me give you a motivation for it. And then I will be more precise later, actually, about what I mean by this. So let me just write two sentences here. So the first thing is the following. So what can I do with this once I found one? So the first thing I can do is that I can consider modulized spaces of semi-stable objects. And so maybe these objects are interesting varieties. And maybe, as I was saying before to Radu, if you're allowed to vary this thing, you can study the rational geometry of those. And so the first thing I want to do is doing some sort of Mumford-Tadeusz principle. I will be more precise later. And I will give you an explicit result of what you can prove on these techniques for modulized spaces. But that's the first thing I want to do. And of semi-stable objects. So there are several questions. I have to prove that these modulized spaces exist, as I said, and they are varieties, and that actually varying stabilities induce something which is complete. And this somehow can be actually done, and I will tell you later, it can be done exactly for surfaces, or better, for K3 surfaces. The second motivation, again, from rational geometry is the following, is that you can imagine this kind of inequality give you something strong, and the strongness that I'm considering here is something related to vanishing theorems. And I will tell you later why, but some of the ideas that this kind of inequality are related to, for example, Bogomolov inequality for sheaves. I will talk about it in a second. And so Bogomolov inequality is well known to have, somehow to be some sort of equivalent, or better, stronger, then, for example, Kodaira vanishing. And or vanishing of other. Somehow, the moral is the following. Whenever you have you have to prove that some group is vanishing, you can try to use stability and use some stability technique to prove that that indeed it vanish. And so I will tell you a bit later about this, but essentially here is the application that you do is for threefolds. And there is a lot of results I can do, and I can also be more precise later about this thing. But at the moment, this is just as an idea. So let me start with the first thing somehow. So let me start with the first idea. So how do I start? So I have a weak stability condition. The idea is that I want to construct a stability condition. So the first operation I do is what we call tilt stability. And so this comes as follows. So I start with a weak stability condition. So I have a heart, I have a rank, and I have a degree. And so the operation I can do is the following. So it is a weak stability condition. So what I can do, I can construct a new heart with a standard procedure of tilting. So this is a new heart. And so how do I do it? Somehow I just use stability to define this guy. So let me briefly. So how do I get this new heart? So I define as follows. Let me just give you the definition. So I'm taking to be the following, to be the set of complexes in DBX with the following three properties. So first of all, I look at the cohomology. So A is a heart, so I can look at cohomology sheaves. And so what I want a cohomology with respect to the T structure A of my object A to be concentrated only in degree 0 and negative 1. That's the first thing. And the second thing I want is the one in H0. So the cohomology in degree 0. I'm sorry. Thanks. So the second thing I want is that H0, I want to be an extension of semi-stable objects. M is my mu. With the property that the slope is positive. And I'm allowing here plus infinity as well. Okay, so if you keep in mind that this example, I'm allowing torsion sheaves are all here. Iterated extension. So somehow the right definition is the following: I want objects in which if I take the harder Riemann filtrations, I want all the factor of the harder Riemann filtration to have slope positive. Okay, so that's what I want here. And similar for H minus 1. So H minus 1, I do the same thing. I want it to be an extension of objects with slope negative. Okay. And the general theory of Hartz says that this is well known in representation theory. And as was discovered in this form by Bridgeland at the beginning of the theory, was that this guy is still a Hart of a bounded structure. Okay. And the issue is that somehow, if you start with a weak stability condition and you pass to this new heart, you somehow improve the situation. That's some sort of miracle somehow. And how does it go, this thing? Well, somehow, if you look at second definition, so I keep in degree 0 object which has slope positive, so which has degree positive, and I moved in degree minus 1 object which has slope negative. So I made the degree positive all over. So I can define a new rank, let me call it R sharp, which is defined as the whole degree. And that this guy here will be positive on A sharp. And so the question is, can I cook up a degree here so that I get a stability condition and I get something which is closer to the previous one? And so here is the non-trivial part. So how do I find this D sharp and why I got closer? So the best thing to do is to see it in an example. And the example I want to show is the one we started with before. So I start with coherent sheaves. Now I want to check how to get something. So let me set an example. So I take A as coherent sheaves. I take R as the usual rank. I take D as the usual degree.
And so,
M is the slope,
yeah. M is the, I just use capital letters. Sorry about that. Yeah, so, so I start with this example. And so what do I go for? I go for, so A sharp is this new category, which I define it as co sharp. I will be a bit more precise later for the moment. So the new rank is the degree. So it's Hn minus 1 C1. And so what is D? And so as I said, for D, I need some property. And the property I need is the following theorem that I will state later, is that if you look at, so this corresponds to mu stability, so the usual slope stability. So slope stable sheaves has this very strong property, which is called Bogomolov inequality, which somehow bound the CH2. And so let me start with writing the definition, then I'll motivate later. So I define the following. So I can take the second chair class. Oh, sorry, let me assume that the dimension is greater than 2 here. Since it's dimension 1, we already could. And I remove, okay, so I just pick a constant because I will use it later. Now at the moment is just a constant times the rank. Okay. So what I claim the following thing. So my state is a lemma. And this was observed in a paper by Arcara and Aaron Bertram and Bridgend. This is a small observation. Let me prove it, actually. That actually, we did simplify the situation. So this triple, A sharp, R sharp, D sharp, is a weak stability condition. So again, satisfies the weak CSO property. And but we improve something, because it is a stability condition if and only if n equal to 2. OK, so at least for surfaces, we actually did improve our situation. So a coherent shift doesn't work, but this new category that I defined actually does work. Let me just give you a small proof of it, just to show it's elementary once you assume Bogomolov theorem, of course.
Sure.
If and only if the dimension is equal to 2.
This is your result.
No, this is the result of them. Okay. See. No. Actually, this is a remark. It's just a remark. So how to prove it? So the proof is as follows. It goes via, as I said, Bogomolov theorem. Let me state it, since we're going to try to generalize it later, hopefully. So Bogomolov says the following thing. Says that if you have a coherent sheaf, which is a slope semi-stable, can assume torsion free, but here it doesn't matter. Yeah, let me state it in a weak form, actually. This is a weak form of the statement. You will need a harder form to do later, but anyway, for the talk is enough, this. So then, let me state as follows. Let me call the discriminant of E, but let me put a bar because it's not a usual discriminant. So I define this as follows. It's a relative of the usual discriminant, but it's not the same if the Picard is greater than 1. So I take the C1, I pair it with h minus 1, this is a number, I square it, and then remove minus 2, h to the n. Did I write the right thing there? Yeah. And then times, this is a number, times the rank, times h n minus 2, times h2 of e. What is the rank of e? OK, and so the theorem says that this quantity is positive. And so now, how do I use this theorem to prove the lemma? So the theorem is used as follows. I will comment a bit later also about the proof, if I have time, about this theorem of Bogomolov. But anyway, so because we are trying to generalize it. So how do I get the lemma from this one? So the only thing I have to prove, I pick an element, A, which is in my sharp category, and I'm assuming that the new rank is 0. Okay, so the new rank means the C1, and so if you look at the definition, the H0 has always C1 positive unless it's everything is 0, and the H minus 1 has C1 negative, and the only possibility that is 0 is when it's all concentrated in degree 0.
So this means the following thing. Then, if I look at cohomology, so the H0 of A, now cohomology is with respect to coherent sheaves. So the H0 of A, the only possibility is that it's supported in codimension greater or equal than 2. And the H minus 1 of co of A, so the only possibility is that it's a torsion-free sheaf. Which is semi-stable, slope semi-stable, so this is the usual stability, with slope equal to 1, to 0, I'm sorry. Okay. And so what happens? So the first case is easy, because if you support on codimension 2, this quantity here is either positive or is 0. So the first part implies that the new degree is positive. And actually, if we are on dimension 2, it's actually strictly positive. And the second condition, now I use Bogomolov theorem. So if m is equal to 0, then it means this part is equal to 0. Rank is positive, so the CH2 is negative. So this implies that the CH2 of H minus 1 of A is negative. Then it's torsion-free, so the rank of the same guy is positive. And so if I plug it here, I get the CH2 is negative minus something which is negative, so this quantity is negative. But I have it in degree minus 1, so it becomes positive. And so this implies that D sharp of H minus 1 of A is actually strictly positive. Okay, so that's a proof. But somehow the issue is that n then equal to 2 is a stability condition by what I told you before. So this strange definition gives you something which is slightly stronger, but for proving something which is slightly stronger, I need to assume some stronger result, which is this one. Okay. So next what I want to do. So next we have two choices. So the first one is to... So the two possibilities we have now are, first I stick to the case of surfaces. And so if I stick to the case of surface, now I have a theory. Now I can try to study my first motivation, which is moduli space of sheaves. And the second motivation is that, OK, this procedure worked for surfaces. I can do somewhat. This is a general thing. I can do one more tilt and try to see what happens for threefolds. OK. So for surfaces, I said you can get something. And now I'm going to show you. And for threefolds, we have some more. I'll try to motivate it later, and I'll try to state somehow we need something stronger like this theorem, and that's what somehow we cannot prove it, but at least we can somehow guess what is the form of it. So let me start with the surface case. Yeah. No, if I go tilting again, okay. No, if I tilt again with respect to the same slope, I got back the same thing. Yes, that's correct. But the idea is to keep going somehow. So I have now a new stability. I can do the same operation again, right? So I get a new heart, so that I can do. The new, again, rank will be the old degree. And the question is, can you guess what is the new degree? So that's somehow the idea.
And but I mean, is it clear that for threefolds you cannot fix the degree there?
Somehow we have a guess of what the degree is, I will tell you. But we don't know how to prove it. Somehow to prove it, somehow you imagine that you need some theorem like this. Yeah, we need another tilt for doing that. Yes, that's correct. Somehow we need somehow. Ah, it's clear. Yes, it's true. It's clear. So again, this is an infinitely leaf, but it's an infinitely leaf stronger. So there exists no two function on this tilted heart for which is a stability condition. So it's that's correct. That's correct. Somehow you can imagine somehow in a threefold you have to somehow here we are just looking at rank C1, CH2, so you need to take care about CH3. And so on in higher dimensions. So. Yes? Yes, somehow we can define linearly, right? It's defined on the on the Grothendieck group of the category, right? Because everything is additive on short exact sequences. So it's actually defined on every object in the derived category. So in particular, it's defined on H0 and on the cohomologies of the previous part.
H0 of A is not
Yeah, it's not in the somehow. Sorry, let me just make a remark. Actually, thanks. Somehow you are using the following fact that if it's A is a bounded, is a heart of a bounded this structure, then what you get that if you look at a Grothendieck group, that's the same as the Grothendieck group of the category, of the derived category. And so it's the same as the Grothendieck group of X. So since these functions are actually defined on A, but they are not defined on A, somehow all this rank and degree, to be precise, are actually defined on K0 of A. So just group homomorphism. And so they are defined, right, by additivity, right? Mm. So that's, yeah. And in this case, somehow, these functions are actually concrete functions, right? In this case, are just these classes, and these are sheaves, right? So these I can define, so even more intuitively. Right. OK, so good. So sorry about this confusion. OK, good. So how do I use surfaces? So the thing I told you here is that I need to vary stability. So here we start getting something interesting. So the first thing I need, I will never be able to get anything interesting if I just keep the one stability, essentially. And so the first part is variational stability. So what it means, variational stability, well, at the moment I can do the following two things. Well, I have H. Why is it fixed? So that's the standard thing that you can do. So in case of H, I can replace it, H, with any ample class on X. And even I can assume real coefficients. Okay. So I just take an ample divisor class, which is a numerical condition. And I'm assuming that the coefficients can be real. And I just replace H in this definition by omega. And the second thing, I have the Chern character. And I can replace the Chern character just by doing this formal operation of twisting it from a class beta. So this simply means I take the Chern character and I multiply by e to the minus beta. Okay? And the beta, what it is, beta, I can allow to be any class in the neuron severity of my surface, of my variety. In this case, my surface with real coefficients. Okay? So now what I have? At least I have something. I have in which I can vary, so I can vary omega and I can divide my B field beta. And so the first technical observation that you have to make here is that by varying these two, you actually vary stability continuously. And that's the first property that you need to consider, and that's actually true. But it's it's using again Bogomolov theorem. So somehow, okay, once I have this one, I can construct by the same way a family of stability, which I denote sigma omega beta. So these are defined exactly the same way by replacing these two numbers, these two elements in this way. So I will have a family of hearts, which depends on these two parameters. I will have a generalized rank, which depends on these two parameters. And I will have a generalized degree, which depends on this omega and beta. Okay, and since I'm in n equal to 2, the same proof will work and will tell you these guys are all stability conditions on dBx. So X is a surface. Eh? So the first lemma you have to prove, lemma 2, as I said, is that this is continuous. So sigma omega beta depends continuously on omega beta. So what does it mean? It means that if I deform slightly and something is stable, I want to be still stable nearby. And if something is not stable and I have X is harder than Hausdorff filtration, I want harder than Hausdorff filtration to deform along, okay, at least locally. And this is true. And the interesting thing is that the proof, again, is not super trivial. And somehow the proof is, again, Bogomolov theorem. And so how does Bogomolov theorem imply this thing? Well, essentially, the idea is the following, is that this Bogomolov inequality goes through, as better variation of it, for objects which are stable here somehow. So this somehow gives you a bound on stable objects. And that is what allows you somehow to do some technicality computation that allows you to deform it. continuous system in the form I told you. Okay. I'll tell you in a second. I'll tell you in a second actually. So that's one operation I can do, and then I can do the following second thing. I can. Yeah, weak stability is enough. I thought there is a small technical part that somehow you need weak stability condition is enough. But I will tell you later about this. But somehow, for threefolds, there is a small technicality, the Bogomolov theorem. Somehow, here is fine because somehow I can choose the stronger one. So here I get C1 squared, so it's good. But here it depends on H. So you will need the form of Bogomolov theorem, which involves somehow only CH2 somehow. And so that's not really, somehow we don't know how to do it. So for that case, you have to assume, I will tell you later, but you have to assume that omega and beta are actually parallel. And it works. But that's just a small technical point anyway. But it's only when you go to higher dimension. But yeah, in general, this statement is true for anything. So it's somehow modulo these technicalities, this statement is true for any variety somehow, for any dimension. So, yeah, to reply to Radu, anyway, at the moment I can construct a manifold of stabilities. And that's where I want to vary somehow. And somehow, locally at the moment, so this is something which is isomorphic, maybe to an open set of the Neron severi of X, two copies, which is big already. But I can play a bit more, and that we'll see later somehow in the talk of Daniel Hoybergs. Somehow you can do more things actually. You can also move them around in stability by the equivalence group of the category. And this definition is so invariant that if I act by auto equivalences, I still get another stability condition. And I can also rotate and still I get some stability somehow. And so I can also act by matrices which have positive determinant. 2x2 matrices with positive determinant. So the action is just on rank and degree. I can just modify them a bit. And somehow the moral of this remark is that you get a complex manifold at the end of the day. Which I denote by stab of dbx. And let me remark, somehow, there is something more you can do, actually, and that happens in the K3 case. Somehow, if you start with a stronger Bogomolov inequality, you get more stabilities, of course. And that happens, for example, as I said again, in the K3 case, you get a bit more larger space. And somehow, you can prove that in this larger space, essentially, this remark consists of all stability conditions you can imagine. Somehow, that's essentially give you everything that you want. But in other surfaces, this is not true, somehow. For example, you can relax a bit by asking. I'll say later about this thing. Yeah, okay, you have to relax a bit. Maybe instead of asking ample, you ask for big and F, for example, and so on. But anyway, so the first thing I care about is the following theorem. I'm almost the first result. So the first theorem is the theorem of Toda. And under all this assumption, and in this stability condition that I get you here, you have the following statement that moduli spaces actually exist. So if I have a stability condition and I fix a Chern class, so something which is in the cohomology, the algebraic part of the cohomology, let me take it with Q coefficients, then is a general result, M sigma of V, which is the moduli of semi-stable objects with the Chern character numerics, which is fixed equal to V. So this thing at least exists, and that is form an Artin stack. And the important thing is that it's of finite type. Over your field, which in this case is C. OK, so that's the statement. And this theorem is also true in general somehow. That's a recent result. It's not published, but anyway. So somehow, under this assumption, is if you keep doing this iteration, moduli spaces will exist as long as you have a theorem of this form, as you can imagine somehow. So a theorem of this form is giving you essentially the boundedness, together with the fact that it's an Artin stack is some result of Max Liebig. Okay, so anyway, this exists. So now we are good. So we have space where to move. We have moduli space which somehow exists. So we can try to prove something by very stability. And this program now, it's sort of developed. And it's particularly developed in the case of K3 surfaces. And so let me state the theorem.
Do you mean the stability condition or just the
weak stability condition? A stability condition. Here, I can also vary weak stability when I go to higher dimension. Then I can do that. But then I will have somehow it's a bit like varying mu stability, right? You will have some, if you go to some barational transformation, you will get some, I don't know, if you think about, you will get maybe a lot of barational transformation all coinciding at once. So. Yeah, they exist as Artin stacks. Somehow it's like when you vary. But it's finite type. Local finite type, yeah. So you need boundedness here. This is actually a general theorem, so it's not written, but it's going to appear in the paper of Toda. So at the moment, we are on the surface case. So the assumption is X is a surface, and sigma, so it's not really a general stability condition, but a stability condition obtained by the one I constructed by acting without equivalence and by rotating. So rotating doesn't do anything to moduli space, and without equivalence also doesn't do anything somehow. But so those are the assumptions. And okay, I want this, of course, to be non-empty, so I want V to be the Chern character of some stable object. But whenever this is, okay, if it's empty, it's fine. Anyway, the answer is that this guy is a finite. Is a finite. Some of the parameter, do you mean the omega beta? So this is exactly what Max Liebig does. So he considers somehow families, somehow this is what you mean, families on X cross U. And okay, you need some condition here. You need to be perfect, exactly, over U. And then you want what you somehow you can imagine. Somehow you ask E restricted to every X cross U, and I want this to be in the category first of all, and that will work. And I want also this to be semi-stable. That's correct. Yes, that's X. Yes, that's correct. Mm-hmm. That's perfect. I did. And then I want the Chern character, of course. To be equal to V. Okay, so that's what I, yeah. And also somehow I need also to construct these for general fields, but that I can do it. That's also fine, yeah. But so these two things, and then I need to prove two things. So this is actually a general result. So whenever I take these kind of objects, and I'm asking that they are in a heart, or if you want, if I ask that the negative X are zero, this is an Artin stack, as Daniel said, or locally finite type. And the condition of being semi-stable is what's fixing the finite netness. And you also need some other thing. You need that this thing is open also. And again, you need some open stability, which is not obvious here, but it's true also. So this is all in these statements. Yeah. OK. Other question? OK. So the theorem that we have is the following. Now. So OK, so that's all good. So this seems all abstract. So I need some concreteness. And the concreteness is via the following fact. And I'm most good to go. So somehow, art is moduli space something interesting. And the interesting fact is that somehow, in our construction, if you let omega becomes very large and being generic, so if I take omega generic and I allow it to be very large in some sense, so for example, if omega is a multiple, I just let the multiple go to infinity, then what do I get? I get that this stack of objects that Toda constructed are actually, they admit a coarse moduli space, which is nothing but the usual stable sheaves. So this is a moduli space of, there is a beta, so this is the notion of Matsuki Wentworth. So this is the notion of twisted stability, but it's Giesecke stability, essentially.
What
do
I mean?
Sheaves. Yeah. So for omega large. Yeah, that's correct. I start somehow, the idea in which I started at the infinity with slope stability. So this is telling you that I can reach actually at a finite step. So there is actually a chamber in which actually it is Giesecke stability. But yeah, at infinity it is, but it's definitely stronger, right? I'm telling you that omega is fixed now, right? So this is true for all of them, right? So that's the thing. And yeah, okay, there is a technical assumption here. I don't want to talk about this thing, but you have to assume that the C1 beta, it's positive. Anyway, otherwise the dual of it, but anyway, or somehow it's some related to it. But anyway, if this is a condition is true, and anyway, it's not so important, this condition. But anyway, this is a moduli space of Giesecke stability. So somehow at a large volume limit, one of these moduli spaces actually exists as a variety, and is a moduli space. And so, and the classical example that you look at, for example, the Hilbert scheme. So if you want to look at the variational geometry of Hilbert scheme of points, then you can realize the Hilbert scheme as a moduli space in this generalized stability. And then you can try to vary stability and maybe get some information on the variational geometry of the Hilbert scheme. So example, if I take V as 1, 0, negative n, you get a Hilbert scheme. Oh, sorry, negative d, you get the Hilbert scheme of d points on x. OK, so this is a certain limit. And then what is the idea? The idea is the following. So you have your manifold, which is the space of stability conditions. And by the fact that stability behaves continuously, you have a wall and chamber structure. Well, and at a certain moment in certain chamber, you get a Hilbert scheme. And so you start moving the chamber and see what happens. And this program works. So this is the first theorem I want to present. This is an old theorem that we have 2 years ago.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So this is still an Artin stack, right? So when I wrote this symbol, it means this guy is an Artin stack as a coarse moduli space. So I can actually contract S equivalence classes, where S equivalence is defined exactly in the same way. And if the vector is primitive, and the stability condition here is generic, then this guy is not only an Artin stack, but is actually a gerb. So it's a sister gerb. So the coarse moduli space always exists. But a priori it's not projective, right? It's just an algebraic space. And here what this theorem says, that this space is actually a projective variety, and this isomorphic has a projective variety to the Giesecke semi-stable sheaves. Okay. This is sort of exotic already. Somehow you get this beta twisted notion. And you get also, for example, you get slope stability. Somehow you get the Uhlenbeck compactification you get. But then omega is not anymore generic somehow. Somehow omega and beta are not anymore generic, but that can happen, yes.
But you always get some
stability. At a large volume, yes. Yes, somehow it's some sort of variation of Giesecke stability. And you can imagine somehow Matsuki Wentworth, somehow when they vary omega, right, then they get a variation of these moduli spaces. So that for example is included actually in what we do. Yeah. Here you can take essentially. So the only let me just do the easy case. So for example, I can take omega as a multiple of h, and I can take beta as another multiple of h, and I want beta to be negative. So, and that way you get the, for alpha large. Sorry? It's Todd class. This is the Chern character. You have to think about, somehow it's a bit. So you mean this omega and beta? Yeah, this is somehow, it's just, somehow the way to think about is, I'm sorry, I don't know why I wrote beta. Okay, beta, okay. S and T. Sorry. Okay, so this is just some other way to think about it, is minus beta minus square root of minus 1 omega, and then times the Chern, then you integrate. So that's the way to think about this rank and degree. Yeah. So, but somehow, yeah, this is somehow the way to think about. So this is a plane. So you can put S and T here and S here. So somehow, if I let S go large, somehow the picture, I don't like too much this picture, but somehow in some talks, for example, you see this picture. So it will be like a largest wall, which actually is a circle. And outside this wall, it will be the Hilbert scheme of d points on x. Okay. So the first wall will correspond to the first contraction on this space. And this vertical wall at beta equal to 0, it's corresponding to the symmetric product. Okay, so this is just a contraction there. And if you take beta positive, it is just the dual functor applied to it. So it's still isomorphic to the Hilbert scheme, but you're not anymore parameterizing ideal sheaf, but parameterizing dual of ideal sheaves, derived dual. Yeah, and so the theorem, as I said, so this is an old theorem we had with Arend, Bayer, and myself. It's 2 years ago theorem. But then I'll tell you later, somehow, if X is a K3 surface, you can do somehow this small little picture I show you here actually works in general. So you just control stability, you can get everything you want. So let me just state the theorem. The first part says the following. If I take sigma in stab dbx generic, so generic here means not on a wall, then what you can prove that such a result actually is true in general. So this moduli space always admit a coarse moduli space, which is a projective variety. So let me write it like this. M sigma of V is an integral. Only for K3 surfaces, this out. Projective variety. OK, or C. So that's the first part. And the second thing is that if you assume more on the vector, you can say more. So if V is primitive, then you can get that the moduli spaces actually exist. And they are also smooth. And by some old result by several people, they're also hyperkähler. So part two. So if I assume that V is primitive, so it means it's not a multiple of anything over the integers, then these moduli spaces are smooth hyperkähler. So smooth, irreducible symplectic, so they have a symplectic form. And that's actually, that's our result, but we use, of course, previous result, of course, by some of the Hilbert scheme of points is a hyperkähler. This was the result by Beauville. Then the moduli space are all hyperkähler. This is the result by Mukai. And then by some of the fact is the hyperkähler is Daniel Heubrechts, O'Grady, and Yoshioka. Okay, and the main thing here is the following, is that they are all smooth hyperkähler and they are all birational. So whenever I change the chamber, these two moduli spaces, either they're isomorphic or they are birational. And the next thing I can do, they are birational, that's inclusive. And the thing is the following, is that if you can control all the walls, you get to control also the transformation between them. And so first of all, they're all birational, and all birational models arise in this way. Okay, so it means that not only they're all birational, but if you want something which is birational and still connected by some flop, okay, not blow-ups, then they are all appear as moduli space of complexes. And once you know this and you know how to study the structure of these walls, then you can deduce the last part of the statement, which is telling you how to compute all these cones. So yeah, they are all, let me restate it. So if you take a variety which is connected by a birational transformation which don't extract any divisor, then it will be again hyperkähler, will be again smooth, and all of them which satisfy this condition will arise as moduli spaces of complexes. Right? So this makes sense. Yeah, so that's, so you don't get blow-ups, no. But all hyperkähler which is birational, in particular all hyperkähler which are birational, then they appear in this way. That happens actually, yeah. Somehow here it happens, but then somehow you get another category. Somehow you will have to retilt the category I defined, but still will work somehow. So for K3 at least. And so you will have another category defined, you will have a stability condition, you will still have modulized spaces, and this result will still be true, actually. So even if you allow omega to be a bit not necessarily ample, it still will work. So that's true. Actually, somehow you can have, for K3 surface, you have a complete description of this stability. And yeah, somehow they are, yeah, somehow essentially this stability, essentially the thing that it's the same to give two vectors in the extended cohomology. And what I want that these two vectors are real and they span a positive plane. Whenever you have these two conditions, then you have a stability condition. So for example, classes if it's square positive, they will satisfy this condition. Yeah. So for modulized spaces, you mean? Let's see. So in this case, you don't actually. But so let's see why. Some of the reason is that I can tell you how these modulized spaces are actually. So what are these? These are actually this one. But how? Somehow the trick is the following. Somehow it's a standard Fourier-Mukai trick. Somehow if you have something which is stable and generic, you will find some vectors which correspond to some K3 surface. So you just Fourier-Mukai, and this modulized space will become a modulized space of, again, Giesecke semi-stable sheaf. Maybe I need to twist them. So twist in the beta sense and twist in the sense of twisted sheaves. So that's so that appears, and it will be on other K3 surface. So then you get some sort of so that you can get somehow, but they are all constructed in this way, so they will all be all modulized spaces of Giesecke semi-stable sheaf, but on maybe another K3 surface. Okay, so that's why you don't get anything. That's what you get somehow. Yeah. Oh wow, I'm way over time. But let me just. Maybe I conclude with surfaces, I guess. So, let me say just one sentence maybe here, and then I'll tell you one line maybe about threefolds. In particular, somehow out of this you get an explicit description, numerical description, of all the cones that you are interested in, of the nav cone, the movable cone, the pseudo-effective cone, the Mori cone of curves, of these modular spaces. Okay, so that's the first thing you can prove. And now somehow you can make this thing work also for P2, for example. And again, the same thing works. And you can make it work for Eureka surfaces or for abelian surfaces. So that's the thing. Because I have 1 minute, I just want to say one thing about threefolds. Maybe let me just state the conjecture, and that's the only thing I want to do. Just 1 minute. I'm sorry about it. Unless there are other questions. So let me just say one thing about. I can tell you explicit description of the cone maybe later. Some of the cone is just anyway. Yeah. So the last thing I want to say about threefolds. So how do I get now? Somehow, as I said, let me assume this technical assumption that omega and beta are actually parallel. So that's the thing I was saying before. And then what we have, we want somehow for threefolds, before even talking about modulized spaces, we want to talk about Bogomolov inequalities. And so this is a conjecture we proposed with R and Bayer and Yukino Butoda, and it was based on several discussions with Aaron Bertram. And the conjecture said the following thing, that if I take something which is tilde semi-stable, so now we are on a threefold, and we have our omega beta of the first tilt, then you get some inequality, which is, okay, I have 1 minute, which is the following. So delta bar omega of C plus nabla omega beta bar of C is positive. So delta is the same delta as before. And this nabla, it's essentially some dual of this guy and up to some constant. So let me just write the definition here. So this is 2 omega CH2 beta squared minus 3 omega squared C1 beta times CH3 beta. So it's something which involves the CH3. OK? Okay, so this is some quadratic inequality. It is a quadratic form of signature 2, 2. And so that's what we expect to be true. At least we expect. It would be very nice to be true. And this will imply stability condition. This implies everything. And you can prove that if delta is equal to 0, so this is always positive. If it's 0, then this is a result by Simpson. So we can apply this result by Simpson and prove that this inequality is true. And let me say one more thing, and then I'm done. And so where do we know this conjecture so far? We know the conjecture for three classes of examples. And then I stop. So examples. So you know it for P3. You know it for the quadric inside P4. This is the work of my student, Benjamin Schmidt. And finally, this is the theorem I wanted to present, but I guess I'm out of time. You know it for abelian threefolds. And that's the result that we have together with the recent result with Arend and Paolo Stellari. And somehow in these three examples, and if you assume the conjecture, you can get you can prove that assuming the conjecture, there exists a stability condition in the sense defined before on a bit more general varieties on all orbifold quotients. Of abelian threefolds. Okay, so that's generally so. This you prove the conjecture here, and this conjecture implies something stronger here. And yeah, I'm sorry, I'm a bit out of time, so I'm sorry. So I think I stop here. Thanks.